What time is it? It's Packard Pokes At time. Hat? Check. Shirt? Check. Pants? Optional. Mug? Double check. Check us out at cafepress.com/PackardPokesAt where you can get all this great merchandise and more.
Do you like Packard Pokes At and want to hear it on demand and on the go? Download the free app today at Stitcher.com. Available on iOS, Android, Nook, and iPad.
This is Packard Pokes At, and I'm poking at your news.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to another fine edition of Packard Pokes At. I am your immutable and unmutable host, Packard Sonic. And joining us tonight from the far east coast is Connie, Practical Magic 9.
I am.
Oh, west coast.
I'm a time traveler. Awesome. Do I have a TARDIS or a phone booth?
If
it's a phone booth, I'll get to be with Keanu Reeves. Awesome. Okay.
I moved the east coast to the west coast and the west coast to the east coast.
You say it's west coast and I say it's east coast. All right.
And also,
I'm somewhere.
You're somewhere. And joining us also from the far other side of the globe, actually, is Lee Lemon.
Hi, I thought I was actually going to be introduced as from the far east coast. So I'm like, oh, it's what? Who? What?
You are so far east, you're actually west.
Yes, I'm so far east, I'm actually on another continent.
That's
so
right.
Howdy.
And join us from the far. Now, this one is actually on the East Coast. Is Bob Schmierfeck?
You nailed it. I am totally on the East Coast.
At least I got one right.
Right.
That's one out of,
right. one out of four times.
Hey, one out of four ain't bad. Where's East? Where's West? I don't know anymore. I'm glad I'm not Muslim. I'd be pointing south probably.
I wonder if that happens, and like who gets yelled at for that.
Yeah, I wonder. You know, it makes me wonder if they do it wrong, will anybody actually know?
If you're on like one of these long distance runs, do you carry a compass with you, and then you're like, hang on, gotta find east. Oh, okay, and then you take a break, and then you pray. Is that how that works? Like if a Muslim prays to the south and no one's around to see it, is it still haram?
We're going to hell in so many religions.
Yes, we're going to hell in all the religions.
Good, let them fight. Let them fight over which hell we go to. She blasphemed against me more.
Yeah.
She was really mean to me. She said this really bad thing. Well, she drew that picture where I was naked. That was a good picture, by the way, for anyone that didn't see that. It's an intimate picture.
I wouldn't say it was anatomically correct.
Right.
It was if you believe in mythology.
Yeah. Speaking of mythology, that's our subject tonight is the mythology of the one thing that the religious people just love to talk about. I mean, it's great for a movie, but that's about it. It's the second coming that never came and never will. Let's talk. Now, there's this site out there it's really fucking funny. If you get a chance to look at this site, it's actually called eBible 2. It's an epic fail. It's eBible2.com. The site itself looks like it was made in the 1980s. I mean, it's really bad.
Oh, yeah. It's terrible.
It's a terrible fucking site. And the
it's
thing,
like the more religious you are, the worse you are at, you know, doing any kind of graphics for your webpage.
Exactly. Now,
but they're in seven different languages, though.
Yeah, they got that part.
Yeah, they put a lot of effort into this, except to present it.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see the coupons on the right side? They look like coupons. I like the one in the middle. No more salvation. God stopped saving people on May 21st, 2011.
Right.
So I guess, so even if we converted today, you're fucked. No salvation for you because they say so. Too bad. Still sad, Charlie.
It's the bureaucracy.
It's a bureaucracy. Like, yeah. I know. It's like always in paperwork, isn't it? You know,
Seven is a gated community, so.
Yeah, it is.
Oh, yes.
When Harold Camping gave his prediction, he said, mark the date. He was sure it's going to happen this time. Like he was sure it was going to happen every other time until he died a couple years ago when his date came up. but on this site here, it says an actual quote. It says, a strong likelihood.
Oh, yeah. That's the weather forecast.
Right. Yeah, I thought God's dealt in absolutes, you know.
Yeah.
But I think this will really happen. Like, there's a strong likelihood if you believe in me, you'll go to heaven.
Right.
I don't think they would deal with that.
These people are so funny. This is not the first one, but it's one of the recent ones that's coming up. John Hagee said that we're going to also have the world's going to come to an end because of the blood moons, and the September 28th is going to be the last one, the fourth and final blood moon in a series. But
I don't know about Connie, but every full moon's a blood moon over here. Oh.
But he's been put down on this, said, hey, we can predict these. This is not something magical that's ever going to happen. I mean, just
right,
because
absolutely.
This is something we can predict. We have no reason to believe. There was a video several months ago when John Hagee came out with this. Some other religious nut that was on the panel with him, which was actually the reasonable one. Hard to believe, but it was actually, he was a reasonable one on that panel.
Yeah.
And he's saying, yeah, no, they actually know how to pick out this stuff, and they do it all the time. And Hagee's sitting there going, huh? What are you talking about, George? Of course, in the Jewish one, on September of 2015, this next month here, Rabbi Chaim Kalowski, he claims that the arrival of the new Jewish Messiah is imminent. Okay, what took him so long?
He had to get ready, you know? He's got to do his hair and shit. I mean, imagine, you are the Messiah coming. Don't you want to make sure you got your hair on point?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
On point, eyebrows looking good.
I don't know if either of you are familiar with the Dark Matter 2525 video channel.
Of
course.
Yeah, he made this great video where, okay, Jesus, you're going to go back, but we want to make sure you're authentic, so we're going to make you brown and make sure you go.
He's like shorter and everything.
Yeah, shows up at the airport. I'm going to send you all to. I'm going to send you all to heaven. Off to Guantanamo with you.
Wait a minute.
That's so great. Now there was also another one. Jean Dixon. She's been dead for a couple of years now. She claimed that Armageddon would take place in 2020 and Jesus would return to defeat the unholy trinity of the Antichrist, Satan, and the false prophet between 2020 and 2037. You know, get a little leeway in there. Anyone else have any more thoughts on this here?
Which list of dates are you looking at?
I'm looking at the one from the Wikipedia of the dates. Oh,
that's a good list.
Yes,
I gotta say, because it started way back.
Put his 2 cents in there a couple of times. My favorite name. Let me see if I can find it.
One person was named Prophet. Their last name was Prophet. That was good.
My under the claimant column. My favorite was in 800 A.D. The prediction made by Sextus Julius Africanus.
Yeah.
I want to party with that guy.
Apparently, Sir Isaac Newton apparently made a prediction. I didn't know this, but he said the world was going to come to an end in 2060.
Oh, yeah.
He said, according to his research of the Bible, Jesus will rapture his church once Jubilee of the time of Israel reacquiring Jerusalem. I thought they already reacquired that already. I mean, they already have Jerusalem, don't they?
Well,
I thought
sort of. But is Jubilee Is that a festival that is yet to happen?
I think it's the lady from X-Men. I'm just saying. Oh. And you're just...
Can you imagine?
Jubilee is usually considered a year of, every 50 years. It's like if you have a debt, actually we're just Jews to Jews, but if you have debts, then they're forgiven. If you have slaves that are Jewish, then you set them free. So I guess the best time to buy a house is like in the 49th year, because then you're pretty clear. So...
Tarvin from the chat room said there's a strong likelihood that guy pulled a rabbit out of his ass, just like all the other animals. he also continued to say the Bible says the Jewish Messiah will come when all the countries have declared peace. Well, isn't that great? He's just on time just to come in and claim everything.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's all my doing. Thanks, everybody, for doing all the hard work. But it was really all me. Sure it was.
You know, he just wants to do it safely, though, because, imagine coming in and getting hit with like a Scud missile or something.
Right. Bobby, you were saying?
I was just, I didn't want to darken the mood, but the fact that they all assume that it's going to happen after the nations have declared peace.
Yeah.
It's a good reason to never let peace happen. I mean, if you're a religious fundamentalist,
oh yeah,
you always are going to want to have that conflict going, so that, I don't know, or maybe I'm just talking out of my ass.
You know, I disagree. I repeatedly refer to Christianity as a cult of death. I mean, that is their goal, is to die. Yep.
Yeah, it is.
And they say to live is Christ, to die is gain. I mean, the end result of a Christian is not to live here. It's not to pass on the message of Jesus Christ. It's to fucking die.
Yeah.
And then end up in heaven. True. And that is it. And that's even true. Still, when you die, you just die.
Yeah.
On Judgment Day, which isn't just named because, you know, Terminator 2 sounded better that way with that subtitle. On Judgment Day, that's when everybody's judged, and then you get to go to heaven. So even though you're dead, you're dead.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean you suddenly get to go, which completely negates all Christian accounts of near-death experiences, by the way. But it's just absolutely ridiculous. So they would want to bring peace.
Yeah.
And that's why there was that issue with George W. Bush, right, and wanting to bring war, because then that way they would stop the conflict. It would end the conflict if we just totally bomb them into the ground, you know?
Yeah.
Right.
Some of these other lists here that are really funny, I thought was really interesting. In 2021, or is that 2025? That's a song. Sorry.
In the year 2525.
That's the one.
that's a good song. That's my end times prediction, that song.
There you go.
As done by Futurama.
Yes. A guy by the name of F. Ken Beshmore, or Beshore, rather. I don't think I want to be a short.
Do they do these do they do these end predictions to kind of justify why their names are so ridiculous? Because if you go through that list, I mean, these guys were made fun of in, you know, elementary school. You can tell.
Yes, they had a hard time. My God, gonna make sure all you die, man. You picked at me. Beshore based his prediction on the prior suggestion that Jesus would return in 1988. Well, he didn't show up then. What do you think he's going to show up now? Within one biblical generation, 40 years of the founding of Israel in 1948, he argues that the prediction was correct. It was. How we're still here. How can it be correct? That you can't argue for something that didn't happen. It's
maybe like 144,000 people died.
Oh yeah, it was just them.
maybe that's what happened. I don't know.
But the definition of biblical generation was incorrect, and it was actually 70 to 80 years, placing the second coming of Jesus between 2018 and 2028. Another one that's like, it could happen in this one or somewhere between here. So that gives us more time to get more money. Yeah, that's it.
That's what it's all about.
That is what it's all about. And he says the rapture will definitely be here by 2021.
I wonder how many of these people are just doing it for publicity and money versus how many of them are actually convinced. I remember going to the youth group in church and being told that we were the generation, because the pastor really, really could strongly feel that we were the generation that would happen before or Christ would come before, you know, our end of our generation.
Yeah. Which they totally get wrong, because in the Bible it says when Jesus supposedly said, I'll be back within your lifetime, he didn't mean the lifetime of the entire planet. He just meant the lifetime of those people who were following him, them. Since he never returned, I bet you they were sitting on their deathbed going, I waited for all this time for Jesus to show up and he never fucking showed up. I'm fucking pissed. I didn't get to get I didn't get a blowjob. I didn't get to have any cunnilings. I didn't get. I turned down the party for that threesome. Fuck.
Right. There's some apocryphal books like the Book of Paul and Thecla, and it just talks about how they had basically said ignore marriage. I mean, Paul is all about that, by the way.
Yes.
It's just nobody get married, because it was this idea that Christ was going to return during this time, even though there was definitely a gap between the time of Jesus and the time of Paul.
Yeah. A large gap between those two.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. But for some reason, it was between his time, you know. So, but if you read about Paul and Thecla, it's about these people that basically they just give up marriage because they're so sure that they don't need anybody. They don't need anything. They don't need, you know, that's give up all your possessions and everything. And God is going to come back. And it's just such a, I mean, it's, we can make fun of it, but at the same time, and we really can make fun of
it. It's tragic.
But, It's really sad, the idea that people look at a child that dies in a horrible car accident and they say, well, good, she's in heaven.
Oh, those people make me sad.
They can look at that and they can say, it's okay, I look forward to death. And they're so sure and so convinced that God is going to return, because for them, the idea of death is something they celebrate more than life. Like, they should be so fortunate, whether there's a heaven or not. They should still consider themselves so fortunate to be alive.
Right.
And instead, they just look forward to death.
Yeah,
that's why
I could. Yeah, when I was involved with the Pentecostal church, that's exactly the same way it was. It's like, oh, be glad you're going to, when you die, you'll be happy because you'll be able to shed all your the body and everything, and you will just be happy forever. Yeah. I think back at that.
Count it all lost.
Yeah. Yeah. Now I look back at it and I go, this is just terrible. This is like, why are these people, they're living for death. They're not living to live.
Absolutely. I was also in the Pentecostal church and I was in youth group during that Columbine shooting. And we were told, which I found out was apparently not even true, that they were going through and only killing the Christians. That's what we were told.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Yes.
And then we were told that they were basically putting a gun to these people's heads and asking, are you a Christian? If they said yes, then you die. And that's what we were told was the account of the situation.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, okay, so if that happened to you, what would you say? Would you die for Jesus? And we all were basically guilted into saying, yes, of course. And we were, I mean, it wasn't just saying it just to say it. It was convincing yourself that, yes, if you were in a situation where someone would kill you for being Christian for whatever reason, you would be happy to do so.
Oh, that's just, I mean, that's gross.
What a thing to drill into a teenager's head, especially, you know, teenagers that are going through a lot of changes.
Mm-hmm.
They already feel a little ostracized, especially if they are like strong Christians. And this idea that there's something else better after this. I mean, hey, you know, just start walking around without looking both ways across the street. Don't wear your seatbelt. You know, hey, Jesus is coming, right? Or, you know, I can die and go to heaven. I can get out of this.
Oh, yeah.
But they just made it seem like
it's such
a wonderful thing.
You know what? I think it also makes people less apt to be motivated to help socially, because, like, there's, like, 8-year-olds working in a sweatshop in Cambodia, that doesn't really peak very high on the radar when in the back of their mind they're just thinking, well, when those kids die, everything's going to be fine. They're going to be taken care
of.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And so it becomes an excuse, maybe not a conscious one at all, but definitely an excuse. And it's an easy way to just sit on your ass.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
There was an incident earlier this year, I remember hearing about that there was a Muslim that attacked a school. It was and they had a lot of Christians in there too. I don't know, and they were supposedly going by the same thing that you were talking about, Lee, where they said that they would go around and ask them if they were Christian or not. If they said they were Muslim, they didn't kill them. If they were a Christian, they did kill them. And these people were happy to die for that. I mean, that just screams to me, like, if someone's got a gun to me and say, hey, are you a Muslim? If you're a Muslim, I won't kill you. I'd say, fuck, I'm Muslim, whatever, dude. Don't fucking
right.
kill me.
I think women would have a little bit harder time convincing them, you know, if we're not wearing a hijab, but yeah. Mm.
Well, they were in their bunks sleeping. I mean, do they wear their hijabs to sleep too? So
I don't know. I think if you wear it to sleep, it's called a do-rag.
You know, just a comment on the hijab.
Yeah.
Around where I live, my favorite use of the hijab is when women use it as a place to tuck their cell phone while they're talking. I see it all the time.
Really?
That's inventive.
It's extremely practical. I look at
them
and I go,
they were like, you know, God, he knew better. Mm-hmm. He knew this was coming, and this is just like his gift to women. He works in mysterious ways. What a wonderful God I serve.
The prophet will never know I put a cell phone in the top part of my hat. There is. That's great.
It's so New York.
that's the equivalency of where women were able to put their cell phones right in between their bra, you know, and they're like, hey, it's now a purse.
Yeah, you put a lot of stuff in there.
I don't have that kind of luck.
You could. There's no reason you can't wear a bra.
That's true.
That's true, Packard.
Especially when you're like a tourist, you know? You don't want to be carrying around a wallet. You can just start stuffing things in your bra.
That's right. Going back in time, we'll go back in time a little bit. We'll go back in time here a little bit. Back in 2012, because remember everybody was going nuts over 2012. It's the end time on December 21st, because I remember when I was a kid, I was watching this thing back in the 1980s. It's like, in 2021 or 2012, December 21st, food processors will just start going crazy. They'll start processing you, and the electronics will go crazy, and your toaster's going to start eating you, which none of that shit ever happened. I mean, I even went up to my toaster. I went, come on, bring it on, boy. Bring it on. And toaster just sat there, looked at me, go, I'm a toaster. What do you fucking want me to do? Give me some bread.
You know, that sounds exactly, you could as easily be talking about Y2K.
Yeah.
Which is interesting because
although it
doesn't have a specific religious connection,
mm-hmm.
it's the same damn thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's the end. The end is going to come because of such and such. And it's just there's something about the human condition that makes us really love this shit.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, it's a good subject for a movie, but I've never seen any good movies yet about the Second Coming.
Yeah, no.
Look at what we're stuck with. We're stuck with Kirk Cameron.
Right.
Kirk Cameron makes me wish the Y2K had happened. This way we would have no technology. We wouldn't have to worry about Kirk Cameron making movies. Because what I did know about computers, Y2K for me was an actual thing I thought it could have happened. It was very probable. Because there was supposedly they were doing tests because of the fact is, you know, these old computers were attached to nuclear missiles and they weren't processing the changeover very well. And there were a lot of problems. And I was actually expecting some power failure to happen or these things to actually go off. But fortunately, they were able to get all this shit straightened out ahead of time. I was a little concerned. I wasn't really super concerned, like I'm going to go build a bunker or anything like that. Which reminds me, I got to make my payment on my bunker.
Yeah, my mom actually started stockpiling food for Y2K, and it was a lot of canned food, and I thought it was interesting. I'm thinking about it now, because we didn't have a hand can opener. We had an electric one.
Mm. Oh.
So how was that supposed to work out? I'm like, all right, we got all this food, and we're just going to hit it until it opens. not sure about the reasoning there.
I like the hand ones anyway, because this way you can take it everywhere you go.
Right. I mean, they're a great thing, but I mean, as a kid, I was so insulated, you know, just because we're Pentecostal. Mm. I had no concept of them. I was so surprised to see one. So to me, they were all electric. And the idea that we had all these cans that did not have pull tabs, and somehow after the world came to a close, after Y2K, we were supposed to be able to open these things with our, you know, without technology.
Yeah.
It was so strange. And we never bought, you know, like, she was buying all this stuff and she never spent, you know, a dollar on the manual can opener.
Got all these cans, like the can opener gotta work. I guess we gotta pound them open.
Right. Just get a rock and just start going. It just never struck me until this moment that we never had a manual can opener, but we had all these stockpiled cans. I just realized it, and it's absolutely ridiculous.
See, this is what
you didn't have. What are we gonna do, pry them open?
I mean, come on.
See, actually, you know, the thing is, you find somebody with a can opener, say, here, I tell you what, for every can you open, I'll let you have like a little bit out of there. So, because somebody's gonna walk around with a can opener, and go, I've got a can opener. No one has electricity. I'm gonna make a buck. Or eat tonight.
Absolutely. Eat like a king. Just like a bigger king.
That is until they kill you, ask to take your can opener, you know.
Oh, that's true. See, yeah. Yeah. And there's no CCTV to catch you.
That's right.
Contact us by email at ppappodcast@gmail.com or on Twitter as @PackardPokesAt. Like us on Facebook.com/PackardPokesAt. Call our Google Voice and leave a message at 662-709-PPAP or 662-709-7727, and we will respond to it on the show. Friday nights at 9 p.m. Central Time, join us live at vaughnlive.tv/PackardPokesAt. During the show, you can share your thoughts with us by calling 857-216-3200 using PIN number 35368 or on uberconference.com/PackardPokesAt. For links to the stories, visit our show page at PackardPokesAt.wordpress.com. You can help support the show by purchasing merchandise from CafePress.com/PackardPokesAt or make a donation to the show at patreon.com/PackardPokesAt. If you can't afford any money, why not share the show with your friends and rate us on iTunes, Stitcher Radio, Spreaker, and on YouTube. For everyone that shares and rates us, you kick ass.
Boy, that kind of makes me really interested. But I think it was Bob maybe that was saying that we were really interested in that with the Y2K being very similar to the end times.
Mm-hmm.
And I agree. I think it's this idea that a lot of people just don't like their situation in life. They don't know how to change it. I mean, there's this idea that whatever you're doing now, past a certain age, that's what you're going to have to do forever.
Yeah.
I remember being in college and finding out that I hated my major. And I was 3 years into it, and I said, well, I'll just change it. Because, yes, I feel like maybe I wasted 3 years, but at the same time, why would I put in another year and then continue to do a job that I hated? But nobody seems to really think like that. They think, well, I already invested 3 years. I better make it 4, get the degree, and just do the job. And for those people, which for me, at least, that I've encountered, it seems like a lot of people are just very stuck or feel very stuck.
Mm-hmm.
Artificially stuck. And just the idea that there would be this huge thing to just end everything and life as we know it will have to change, that can be very appealing to them.
Yeah.
I think you're absolutely right. And I think
like a reset button.
Yes, like a big
reset. Yeah, like a reset button, you know? And then, I'm not sure what they would be doing, you know, if you're like, oh, man, I studied engineering and I hate it. That's all right. I really want to be something else that involves technology.
Right.
You know, and then Y2K happens and you're just being a farmer.
Yeah. We had a tweet come in from the Taliban cat. Thank you, Taliban cat. It says, Jesus will never return. Muhammad Prua has tied him to the bed wearing a ball gag and rubber crown and thorns.
Oh, KK. I like the rubber crown and thorns. I like that. And you said it was Taliban cat. Taliban cat, if you want to check out Lee Lemon or Lee underscore Lemon with the O as a zero. If you type in like Lee Lemon Twitter and then you type in everybody draw Muhammad Day, you'll find my very not safe for work. It's sort of similar to what you've described.
There you go.
Not safe for work drawing.
So checking what would be their safe word?
Yeah. What, praise him or?
Another tweet came in from Karen 33333. He says, I've never met a Christian who didn't think they were going to rise to heaven when Jesus came back. Yeah, that's very common. This like, oh, I'm a Christian. I believe in God. So when the end times comes, then I'm going to go right up to heaven. Speaking of which, real quick there, when I was involved in the Pentecostal church because I had my head rolling around and all that stupid crap.
Oh, yeah.
They had me, I was thinking about it, and I actually had this weird-ass dream. That's like I'm driving down the road or whatever towards this one area where I used to live. I don't live anywhere near there right now. But I was like, I'd see like nuclear bombs going off left and right, and that was going to be the end of the world. So if I never go down that road, it'll never happen.
I remember what I read in Revelations about only 144,000 being saved.
Oh, yeah.
I said, hey, you know, we're all supposed to be, you know, resurrected or, you know, raptured up into heaven. And yet it says only 144,000 will go. And these are only from the 12 tribes of Israel. You know, what's the deal with that? And the pastor was saying, well, you know, they're going to go straight into heaven. The rest of us are going to go to the new earth.
Like, the okay, new earth.
Yeah, I said, well, where's that?
It's, you know, like
here's my Bible. Point to the, you know, where's that? Where does it say that? Like, I wasn't saying this to be challenging or anything. It was just, oh, cool. Where is that? So I can read more about it. And they said, oh, you know, we just have faith. And, oh, it's from other parts of the Bible and this, that, and the other thing.
Yeah. Bob, you were saying?
Here's the thing I don't understand. In Matthew 24. Where it's talking about the rapture and mm-hmm. the second coming and all of that jazz. And I don't think this is the only place where he says this, but he says it very clearly here that nobody knows the day when
yep.
it's going to happen.
Yeah.
Nobody, not even me. It's
yep.
going to be the, you know, the other part of myself that's on the other hard drive partition.
Yeah.
And but that's a whole other issue. But the fact that he says nobody knows, which means two things. One, the question is, why then? Why are all these predictions happening? Are people not aware of these verses that say basically it's impossible to know? You can't know.
Yeah.
And also, the other thing is, I wonder if Jesus is thwarted every time somebody makes a prediction.
Mm-hmm.
Because if they say, oh, it's going to happen on December 21st, 2012, then Jesus has to go, oh, crap, that's a blackout date. We can't go there. because we
can't let the humans be right. We're going to come on a Tuesday after dinner time, and we're going to fuck up everybody's weekend, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
So, well, yeah,
I mean, I've asked people that, you know, I've asked them, like, why they say that, why they're going to make a prediction when the Bible clearly says nobody knows, not mm-hmm. even Jesus. And I ask them if they're smarter than Jesus, and they say, no, I didn't make an exact date prediction.
Oh,
I just
that's
said,
the excuse.
Coming soon.
Coming
and,
soon,
okay,
to a theater
really?
Near you.
But with the people that do make an exact prediction, like with the Jehovah's Witnesses, for example, you know, and if you ask them about it, a lot of times they'll say, well, it's because there's things in the Bible that tipped us off. Like God put a code in there for us to crack. And I'm like, but that doesn't address the verse
that's
at
such,
all.
Yeah,
what?
That's such bullshit.
It is. You know, the thing is, you were talking about the only a certain number of people. I guess God didn't make enough rooms, or he can't
right.
make enough rooms. I mean, and then the other part is when they say only so many people are being saved, is like, so what number are you in that list? And how do I get to your number? I mean, I want to make sure I kick your ass out so I get your space. And, right, and if right, there's, absolutely. Why would you go around telling people about this if rooms are limited? I mean, it's like if I had special concert seats that are only so many people can go, and you only a few people are gonna be, or a few people are gonna be able to get in. I'm not gonna go around. Hey, everybody, Corey, try to get to this concert that you can't get into.
And yeah, what if you missed the cut by one person?
Was that Bob?
What if you missed the cut by one person?
Yeah.
What? One person over the line. What happens to you then?
I knew I should have slipped another Benjamin into the tournament.
Right.
Yeah. Maybe you get like a T-shirt as a consolation.
I made it all the way to heaven, and all I got was this lousy T-shirt.
Yeah, exactly.
That's good.
You go to hell, and it ignites in the first 2 seconds.
Dawkins Dog said some dick on Facebook said he would be happy to know people were suffering in hell because whatever makes God happy makes him happy. That's fucking sick.
Isn't that sick?
It is sick. I mean, it's like,
absolutely.
What's really bizarre about people like this, they say, well, if I die and someone goes to, let's say your relative doesn't believe in God like we don't, right? And they're afraid they're going to go to heaven and their relative or loved one is going to go to hell. And you ask them, are you going to be happy there? And if my mother's going to, or my mother or my dad or whoever is going to be happy being there, knowing that I'm going to be burning. And if they say yes, and then that person I'm related to isn't them anymore because you've changed them or altered their state to make them to be happy that the fact that I'm burning. I mean, I'm sure that they love me enough that they wouldn't want to see that.
Oh, absolutely. Gosh. And, you know, people say that it's like this biblical prediction that, you know, families will be torn apart by religion and that, you know, Jesus will come to basically, you know, he doesn't come by with to bring peace, but he comes to bring the sword to tear people basically away from each other to find the true believers that'll follow him, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they make it seem like it's this big prediction, like, oh, they knew this would happen. Well, no shit.
Yeah.
If you got one family member ranting and raving about some crazy deity that was really himself and sacrificed himself to himself, even though it wasn't a sacrifice because he was brought up on the third day and you got to eat his body and drink his blood and then he goes up into heaven and then but he's going to come back, but he hasn't yet. Well, maybe your family's going to think you're crazy. You know?
Just maybe.
I mean, maybe they're going to disagree with you. And I mean, maybe the rest of your family is religious. Maybe they're a different religion.
Mm-hmm.
So even that is going to cause a rift, you know, between the family members. So it's not this big predictive thing. Oh, they knew it would happen because, you know, Jesus is so great and he makes Satan so angry. No, it's because you're ranting and raving about some guy that you've washed yourself in his blood,
mm-hmm.
and then he's gonna come back and take you by your hand into heaven. Like that's a little bit nuts.
Yeah,
actually you know what, that's not even nuts, that's pretty metal actually. Take your God and like you nail him to some gnarly cross and you bathe in his blood after you ate his I mean that's pretty metal.
I never figured out how they can reconcile that exactly. I mean, you know that you're supposedly transferring the body and blood of some deity that died from a cracker. I mean, I always say, hey, if you're going to eat this thing, do something with it. You know, put some cheese whiz on there, a little bacon maybe. You know, oh, no, bacon's a sin. Forget me. Sorry.
little crab spread.
A little crab spread, peanut either. Butter, something. Make it taste worthy, you know. Then all of a sudden, then all you got left is just peanut butter in your mouth.
I have a question.
What if
it's
just
hey,
like
Lee,
all the animal gods from other religions, as, and then you put their meats onto this like Jesus cracker? Is that okay?
Yeah, good question. Bob had a question for you, Lee.
Oh yeah, you grew up Pentecostal.
That's correct.
Did they believe in transubstantiation?
Not at all. Not at all. No, that's okay. That was the Catholic thing, and the Catholics are idolaters and Satan worshipers. They worship Mary more than Christ and all this other stuff. We were told that this is the this is a symbol. This is a symbol of my body. This is a symbol of my
which
blood.
That's what they told us too. And I wasn't Pentecostal, but I was definitely in a conservative,
the
literal Word of God sort of Christian sect.
Yes.
But they always told us that, oh, this is symbolic, you know, it's a metaphor. And they would say, It's crazy to think of that as being literal. How could you do right. that? But then the things that they really think of as literal, like Adam and Eve and all the rest of that, I just blows my mind.
Absolutely. I completely agree with you. And I think the weirdest thing for me was they were saying, well, this is a symbol and this is all this other stuff, you know, do this in remembrance of me, blah, blah, blah. But it was strange because to me, just even as a Christian, it seemed a bit sacrilegious.
Mm-hmm.
I guess sacrilegious because yum, yum.
I actually have this picture. I actually have this picture on my hard drive. I have a picture of Jesus up on this cross there, and it shows the different meats. It's like you got the ribeye over here, and you're this part for like the steak over here, Jesus steak, you know. They keep good in the
that's
freezer,
great.
You know.
Do they? So that's good. Up to 6 months. But to me, it was a little bit sacrilegious because the idea was that Jesus was the one saying, "This is my body," and then he broke bread. And Jesus was the one saying, "This is my blood," and he had the wine. But now some dude is up there doing it. Some pastor. You know what I mean? It just seemed a little strange. Dude.
Yeah.
Like he took on the role of Jesus. And as Pentecostals, we were really, you know, against the idea of the Pope.
Mm-hmm.
Why would the Pope be the connection between God and man? That's right. Jesus. Jesus
yeah.
was the connection right. between God and man. And so this idea that, well, now I'm going to have like this guy play the part of Jesus. Like he's got to stand in for him, you know? And it just seemed really
playing
strange.
The part of...
And I thought, well, was this something like, was this a one-off thing? Like, Jesus was just saying this for his disciples and, like, do this in remembrance of me. Well, am I supposed to just remember God? Like, why do I got to eat a piece of bread and, like, drink some grape juice? And
play in the
they
part.
Always talked about, like, how they just kept changing it. They're like, well, first of all, Jesus drank wine, but we're not going to do that because we got people here that's underage. And so we're going to do grape juice. That's the next closest thing. But we're going to do white grape juice because just in case anybody spills it, then it's not going to leave any stains on the floor. And I just thought, like, how much further are we going to take it? Like, well, since it's just cleaner anyway, let's just make it water and then let's just make it nothing. How about we just do – I mean, if it's symbolic and memories of Jesus, like, why are we doing this anyway? It just didn't make any sense to me, even as a Christian.
Yeah.
I was a very strong Christian.
Yeah.
And even that just didn't make any sense.
You know, the one thing about what you were saying there about having the priest stand up there, he's standing in for Jesus, is like playing the part of Jesus today will be Pastor Bob. You know?
Right. Yeah, it just seemed really... I don't know. I think for me, like, it's. I know it sounds really strange because, you know, Pentecostals are so literal, but... I was really skeptical of a lot of the things that we did because I thought it didn't follow the Bible enough.
Yeah.
And I just thought it was so strange. Like, the more I started reading the Bible, the less Pentecostal I became. Especially the part in, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10, where it talks about, you know, be of all one mind and let there be no divisions among you. And I thought, so why are we in a sect of Christianity if there's not supposed to be any divisions among us?
Yeah.
And that's what really started me leaving.
You know,
I joked that I was so Christian. The only thing that made me an atheist was reading my own Bible.
Yeah,
I wasn't listening to anything, you know.
When I was involved in the Pentecostal church, I was actually listening to them really intently, and I was getting the same kind of questions. I was like, you know, some of this stuff didn't make sense to me. So I actually was paying more attention to it. A friend of mine who got me involved in it, he's still involved with religion, but the fact is, he must not have been paying attention, I guess. So that's why he's still religious, I guess. Bob, you were saying, Bob?
Oh, nothing important, I swear.
You have been to the show before.
I remember, I think I was thinking about something Lee just said about how that you said, then why are we in a sect?
Mm-hmm.
And
it made me
think that the answer from everybody that is in a sect, like all the different churches, their answer is, oh, but we're not in a sect. Everyone else is in a division. They're in a sect.
Right. Everyone else is wrong. We're the true Christians.
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, my God.
Everyone's the true Christian. Everyone's the right Muslim. Because, it's the same thing with Islam. There's a lot of different ways to believe in it.
Yeah.
But they, for some reason, everybody thinks they're in the right one. I mean, that's how people are anyway.
Yeah.
Because if I was in the wrong one, then I would have changed.
Oh, yeah.
Well, if everybody could realize that we have all created God in our image, that's
all that it is. And so God is always reflecting our ideas and our beliefs. You know, mm-hmm. we build our beliefs around what we are comfortable with or what we're questioning. And, you know, we want to know who God is. We look in the mirror. I mean, when I deconverted, it was really strange. I think that was one of, like, the second things I realized. Is like, so everything I believed, it was just me answering my own questions. Or, you know, and filling in the blanks. And the struggle I was having was how disjointed the Bible was.
Mm-hmm.
That everything right. it says about God or about religion in general, how can people not see that women are not supposed to talk in church? I mean, I didn't want to be yeah. told I couldn't talk in church, but that's a edict in the New Testament. Yeah. And I'm like,
yeah. It says it very clearly, too. And I have mentioned that. I used to bring up religious questions on Facebook mm-hmm. once in a while. I have since made a rule that Facebook, I don't talk about religion or politics because it's
make
it's
a separate Facebook account. I highly encourage that.
Yeah, right. Good advice. But anyway, real name. I used to say things that were a little provocative to some religious folk.
No.
And, yeah, right. And so I once mentioned the treatment of women and how women, you know, were supposed to be silent in church and that this is the way that, you know, religion values women. And right. the very, very religious woman that I was talking to came unglued.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
She was like, mm-hmm. No, they don't. And I was just like, well, it's not me saying that. It's Paul. It's mm-hmm. the Apostle Paul.
Right. Absolutely. I will say, you know, in because I did look a lot of this stuff up. I mean, my leaving Christianity was not overnight. It took several years, and it was something that I had found, you know, like, well, what other people were saying, you know, non-believers, you know, those dirty atheists, they were telling me that the religion I was in was so against women. So I started asking questions about it, and I found one of them, and I remember talking with this woman. She was very very much a feminist and talking about how Christianity was against this, that, and the other thing. And she said, well, it says that women must be subservient to men. And I said, where does it say that? And she said, I said, well, that's in 1 Corinthians chapter 7.
Mm-hmm.
And it says in the same sentence, and likewise, a man must be subservient to his wife.
Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. so I thought, okay, mm-hmm. great. But then I started looking more, like I was always told Adam was blamed for the fall, not Eve. I was told in church. But if you read the Bible, nope. It keeps going back to Eve and how she was this terrible thing. And it's interesting.
At least we can't blame Lilith.
If you want to talk about Lilith, yeah, absolutely.
Now there is some.
It was just really strange because there is some stuff in there that's, and you know, it was just like, why does it say that women shouldn't talk in church? Well,
yeah.
It's because women were not allowed to be educated, and so they would say stupid things.
Right.
It's like, well, okay, I guess I get that, but aren't you being educated of churchly things in a churchly way at church?
Yeah.
So maybe she can't speak up against, you know, about algebra. But if you're talking about something, and then who speaks up in the church other than amen, brother, and oh, preach it?
Oh, yeah.
Who speaks up in the church? You know, who's going to say, excuse me, can we cross-reference this with this other thing? And like, don't listen to her. She's a woman. She can't read.
Right. On this list here that's from the Wikipedia here, now there is some end-of-the-world stuff that is actually probably more factual. Believe it.
Oh,
it's
yeah,
actually real factual.
And all that other stuff.
Yeah. This one is in the year 500,000 years from now. This, according to James Kasdan, a leading scientist, according to the scientist, the level of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere will drop dramatically, making Earth uninhabitable. This is coming from a scientist. If carbon dioxide is not here, then I guess we kind of need a little carbon dioxide along with our oxygen and nitrogen, because carbon dioxide levels drop, the plants can't breathe because they suck in carbon dioxide, they've kind of filter it. And there's another one in 5 billion years from now that the sun's current phase will swell into a red giant, either swallowing the Earth or completely scorching it. as it is widely accepted in the scientific community that the Earth will be destroyed around this time. However, the sun will grow gradually hotter even over millions of years, and Earth may become too hot for life in only a billion years. So if you got that sunscreen contract and you've got a
put your stocks
and sunscreen in 5 billion years, I'm telling you, you're gonna make a bundle. You won't be allowed around to enjoy it, but hey, you know.
who's to say we wouldn't evolve,
right?
Yeah,
we're evolving into something. Who knows what we're evolving into?
I was just curious about everybody when they were reading through that. I mean, how did you feel about that scientific stuff being in there with all this religious stuff?
Well, no, that's
I felt like it was almost, like, I mean, yeah, I get it. It's sort of an end of the world thing, but it's not really a end times prediction. Because when I think of end times, I think that's framed within religion.
Yeah,
when I think end
I
of the
that.
World,
yeah.
that can be anything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, but I think the first prediction about the world ending, I don't remember if it was in the Bhagavad Gita, but it's a very ancient manuscript. And, you know, religion in general, and this specifically, it's all about our own mortality.
Mm-hmm.
We want to feel like our lives mean something.
Yeah.
And we understand that we are all going to die someday. And even if we're not here, we do worry about life extinguishing and what would our purpose have been.
Right.
I just think maybe that's somehow in our DNA. I don't know. And because we can't talk to animals, really, we don't know if they don't think about this kind of stuff.
Right.
They don't appear to. But mm-hmm. I think it's
they
about
They
all
want to live. Plants want to live. Everything wants to live. I would say that
right.
is within our DNA, because otherwise I think we would have died off a while ago.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, to procreate and to, you know, to move on to the next generation. This is a great cartoon. It shows like a certain with like a fish thing, and then the last part is a person, and then there's a thought bubble that says eat, survive, reproduce. Eat, survive, reproduce. All the way up until you get to the man, and then you got the guy sitting there, you know, all dressed up, and he goes, "Oh, what's the purpose of life?" It's like, dude, you completely fucking lost it. It's been every generation before you. Eat, survive, thrive. You know, that's it.
Yeah. Absolutely. That's why I make a joke that because some people say, "Oh, Lee, you're really cool," whatever, and I say, you know, I'm glad most people aren't like me, because I think our species would die off. Because I'm totally like, I just do not want to reproduce. I'm really not a big fan of like interacting socially. I'm like, I'm really happy most people are not like me, because our whole species would just die off. I'm like, oh, there's a kid, let's take care of it. Why make another one? Like, I don't. One's as good as another. I guess I would have been a good Job. You know, oh, 10 kids died, but God just replaced them. The same.
Yeah.
So, you know, but I mean, that's really the purpose of life. And it's the purpose of life as a de facto thing, because if our ancestors did not have that drive, we would not be here today. And it's really that simple. It's not that reproduction is the purpose of life. It's that the purpose of life is to live. So reproduction and not wanting to die, that is just a byproduct of it. And that's I think we're looking at it backwards.
Yeah.
You know, like, why am I alive? Why do I want to continue living? It's because you want to continue living that you're alive. That's why you're alive.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Dawkins Dog tweeted and says, "I plan on living forever. So far, so good." There was a comedian who basically had that same line. He says, "I'm in the Live Forever Club." And he was asked, he pretended like someone is asking him, "So what happens if you die?" "Fuck, well, you're out of the club."
Well, what, I mean, what's your purpose, you guys? What's your purpose of life? My purpose I've set for myself is just to learn more and help people. Like, what's your purpose?
Yeah, my purpose in life is to try to help people if I can, or make them laugh. I was down just the other day. I was down the other day helping my daughter pick out groceries because she's moving into college again. And there's this guy just standing next to us, just behind us, not really paying attention. And we were looking at this stuff called chicken rub. And it was like, and there was pork rub and chicken rub. I was like, pork rub, that's good. And the chicken rub, I said, chicken rub, you know, chickens really don't like it when you rub them. And this guy's like,
you just like, are you new in town? You guide me.
He's just like, he says, start shaking his head, go, oh, that's just too funny. He's like, just, he's like, I got someone to laugh.
You feel a little tense.
I think laughter helps people. I mean, yes. I would definitely list that under helping people. I think one of the things that we have to do is to not take ourselves so seriously.
Right.
There's a tribe in some Bushman kind of tribe that they use sarcasm excessively because they don't have a hierarchy in mm-hmm. their tribe. And so it's this idea that it keeps people humble.
Right.
So they always laugh and everything, you know, they don't want to take themselves seriously and they don't want anybody else to take themselves seriously either.
It's
and I think
great,
that's a good
it's
thing
a great
to
way
remember,
to make fun
you know?
Of yourself.
Right.
And while acting like you're, you know, bigger than you are.
Right.
It's just a great way to role play and process out.
Absolutely. Just satire is a great way to do it.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, we have to get going. Lee and Bob, I want to thank you both for coming in and helping out with the show tonight. Lee, where can they find your channel?
Well, my channel is youtube.com/LeeLemon with the O as a zero. Lee Lemon is also my atheist Twitter. And for anybody that's interested, we didn't talk about it, but fitness, I'm actually a personal trainer. And you can find me on Twitter @LemonLifts. And that O is not a zero.
All right. Excellent. Cool. And Bob, where can they find your channel?
On YouTube.
YouTube. That's a good place to start.
.com/BobSmearFack. It's hard to spell. Just look for it. There's all kinds of... Whenever I search, I've looked for it in Google, and I could see all of the ways that different people had searched for it and all of the creative spellings. You'll find it eventually.
Yeah.
But it's Bob Smearfack. And same name for my Twitter, which I rarely ever tweet from.
Yeah.
You got to tweet. It's a good way. I got a lot of my people on Twitter. It's a good time.
Yes.
I've got to figure out a way to get myself motivated to do it and to know what to say. I don't.
Hey, I thought the first 10 was going to be hard, and I'm well over 200,000 or 200,000 tweets on mine. So
good God,
really?
Man.
Nice job.
Thank you. I hardly tweet on it anymore though, but I still, hey, it's an accomplishment. Fishhead said, damn, Bob, you should have taken time to spell it out.
You got a problem, Packard.
I know, I have
a problem.
I went to Tweeters Anonymous. They took my tweeter away.
I just want to say real quick, when I was in university, there was this professor we had who was he was actually a pastor as well, and he referred to it as the twatter.
The
and
twatter.
Nobody corrected it. We all just looked at each other like, is this a joke or does he not know? And then, you know, how can you correct him? Like, twat is not a word you want to say in a situation. But he called it like the Google. He called it the twatter.
Oh.
And we just, oh, it was silence and red faces everywhere. It was insane.
At least it didn't call it the twatter machine. Now that's a sex
that's
product,
a
by the way.
That's a dildo.
That's a sex toy. Anyway. All right. Well, we do got to get out of here. I want to thank again our special guest hosts for joining us tonight, and I want to also thank Connie for also, you know, helping with the show, getting it prepared for this week. And we'll be back.
And for going back in time.
And going back in time. Absolutely. We went back in time.
No. That was awesome. I got to hang with Keanu.
Yes.
Or the doctor.
And the doctor. And we'll be back next week with our regular long show. And we'll see you then. This has been Packard Pokes At. We just poked at your news.
And that's a wrap.